Folks, Ann is running a little late, and she made the call to the bullpen again for the left-hander to do tonight's introduction. My name is Kevin Barry. The title of tonight's program is A Walk Through History. Tonight's speaker, Mark McGrath. Mark has given more than 50 talks to groups on Cape Cod. The topics include Cape Cod adventures, walking the perimeter of Cape Cod, a celebration of Cape Cod, in the history of the Cedar Bank Links Golf Course. Mark has been a longtime hike leader for several groups. He's had a one-person photography exhibit at the National Seashore, and he and Patty told their story of the Cape Perimeter Walk on NPR Radio. As you can imagine, he has an interest in photography, Cape Cod history, adventures, and telling stories about our wonderful Cape Cod. Tonight's sponsors are Marcy and Bud Nugent and Lizzie Magruder. Please thank them. Don't miss next week's lecture featuring the ever-popular Greg Williams. Greg will be here with a presentation on Lizzie Borden. The murders, the evidence, and the birthday. The story of Lizzie Borden as only Greg Williams can tell it. In honor of Lizzie Borden's 163rd anniversary of her birthday, we will have cake and ice cream, and everyone is invited. However, we ask you to leave your axes and hatchets at home, or at the very least, check them at the door. Also, no gifts are required. And for those of you who know Anne, you didn't hear it from me, but tomorrow's her birthday. Without further delay, please give a warm Tales of Cape Cod welcome to Mr. Mark McGrath.
Thank you. Well, thank you all. My name is Mark McGrath, as we mentioned, and I am a native of Boston, lived my working life in Connecticut, and as I was about to retire in Connecticut, we said, where do we want to go to retire? And the answer was, let's go to a place the kids will visit us. So today, we have our three kids, their spouses, and seven grandkids spread throughout the audience here. So that's really worked. Well, tonight's story is about adventures and artists. So we'll talk at first about some of the adventures Patty and I have had. And then the Cape is noted for quite a few artists that have had Cape Cod in their bones. And we'll talk about those for a little bit. Start off with adventures. As he mentioned in the introduction, Patty and I walked around the perimeter of the first slide. You know, how could it work 10 minutes ago and not... We'll skip around as part of the adventure series here. You've all heard of the dunes in Provincetown. Well, they have dune shacks out there. There are 19 of them. And if you're part of the public, you can stay in several of them that offer lotteries to stay in these dune shacks. And Patty and I were lucky enough to win the lottery on three different occasions. So I'd like to introduce you to the dune shacks. This is the most luxurious dune shack. We stayed in that twice. In fact, I'll give you a tour, a real estate agent's tour. Come on in and I'll show you around. There's a comfy bedroom on the left there. There's another bed for naps during the daytime. There's a dining room table with lots of windows and lights to read by at night. There's a living room with a wood-burning stove. There's a well-equipped kitchen. And there's even a well with a great view. And there's even a separate building with a toilet in it. It's near the ocean. The neighbors are great. Great, fantastic backyard. And when the grandkids visit, they love it. And those little kids now are in their 20s, so this was a while ago. And it's a historic place. The scenery and hiking is fantastic, and it's near a big city. What more could you want? There's another dune shack called Seascape, and that's primarily for artists. And to get that dune shack, you have to submit your portfolio to a judge panel, and they have 1 week that's up for grabs. And they said, pay $25 extra when you mail in your application, and we'll put you in the lottery. I didn't believe it. I said, this is the last year I'm going to do it, and I won it. So we're there at the Seascape. And for the first 3 days, we said, what previous tenant caught those bugs and strung them up? We were disgusted. And somebody walked in and said, Mark, those are just Rosa Rugosa buds turned upside down. The hiking's great up there. And one of the things to do at night, there's not much to do, you can't really read by those lanterns. It's getting those lanterns to light without smoke. I never finished that, really. But I took this picture, kind of emblematic of what it's like. And then I noticed on one of the walls was a pinup, and it was a poem written by Nancy Oliver, and we'll talk about her a little bit later. She's a Pulitzer Prize-winning poet, and she just loved Provincetown. Every day of the year for 20 years, she went out and walked around the pond. And I'll just read a couple of the words. 8 o'clock, no later, you light the lamps. The big one by the large window, the small one on your desk. They're not to see by. It's still twilight out over the sand. You light the lamps because you're alone in your small house, and the wicks sputtering gold are like two visitors with good stories they will tell slowly. And there's just so much of that dune shack in that one poem. We went down to the beach one night. We thought we were alone in the whole area to watch the sunset. And we saw those camping trailers. And initially I thought, what are they doing wrecking my view? And then I said, that's kind of arrogant. They've spent a lot of money just to enjoy the same thing I'm seeing. So I felt we were kind of like a group just enjoying the same sunset. Okay. Let's try another one. Oh, that one worked. Another adventure that I had was walking across Pleasant Bay. And if you look at it on Google Maps or something, that's quite a walk. It's 2.7 miles across that open water. And that was kind of scary when you first look at it. But if you look at Google Earth, you find out at low tide, there are a lot of sandbars. So you can walk that 95% on sandbars at low tide. But first, to see if it would work, you go out in a kayak, and you scout it out, and you get out and walk. Then you do a few more scouting trips. And here's what you do. You go out in the middle of Pleasant Bay, and you throw your anchor over, and you get out. And at this particular time, I threw the anchor over, and I get out, and I walk for 20 minutes, so maybe that was a half mile. And I turned around, and the kayak was gone. And you know that shot of adrenaline that goes through your body when you just hit a shock like that? I had that. But then you look at it, and I saw a speck of orange. Of course, a quarter or half mile away, the canoe looks about this big, and I said, ah. And I had it back, and it didn't Didn't amount to much, but that's the way you scout it out. And then another thing you do is recruit a good partner. And that Jack Fowley was my partner there. And he was a nice partner because he had just finished hiking the entire Appalachian Trail. So when I was discussing, I said, hey, come and walk with me. He said, don't you have any questions? He said, no, if you think you can do it, I know I can do it. So he didn't need any premonitions. There's Jack. There's the ones walking across the sandbars with the one swim across the back channel. And then you walk to Nauset Beach to get your car. Okay. Little Sipson Island is nice. We kayaked out there. It's about an acre and a half big. And there's a sign there that says, you're welcome on Little Sipson, but please, no camping. Then I saw the sign, without permission, and it gave a phone number. And so I called up the phone number, and I said, I'd like to camp out there. And the woman that answered said, well, what night do you want to do it? And you're welcome to. So we get out there, and we had stayed on a previous island in a tent. Gather some mussels. You have your White Shark Hog's Island beer, some lasagna, just a great meal. And then in the previous camping out, I was in a tent. And it really frustrated me. I wanted to see the sky. And you have a tent over you. It was a mess tent, but you couldn't see anything. I just wanted to get that feeling. So I had read where there are things called bivy bags, and you can put your sleeping bag inside a bivy bag, and it protects it from all the elements. So I slept like that at night. After the sun went down, I remember the moon coming up, and that was just a thrill. And then I fell asleep, and I woke up, and the moon had moved about 2 inches. And I said, well, I'm never going to get to sleep. And then again. Now I was getting worried. But then the stars came out. The moon went down, and just the sky lit up with stars. And just lying there looking at those stars was just a fantastic experience. That's Starry Starry Night. That song is Starry Starry Night by Don McLean. And you wake up in the morning, you have a cup of coffee, and then you head back. Jack was much faster than I was in the kayak. But that sleeping on there is great. Now let's, I'll try this one. Another adventure, not a dangerous adventure, is, have you ever thought of having a full moon beach party in February? No? You know, that was just an idea. Let's do it. Let's do it. At Cape Cod evenings are all 25 degrees or above. And if there's no wind, 25 degrees is not that hot. So all, if you have a fire, it really can be quite pleasant. Hey, build a fire. Bring a lot of good food. More of the fire. And one of my partners said, I'm going to bring a flag, and we're going to put up the flag. And there was something about being on the edge of the beach and having this big flag behind you. And we had a song leader. Now that was a very special night to me. There were 66 people at the picnic, and to have all 66 people just belting out that song was really made you feel good. You know, you sometimes wonder, could we do that again? I don't know, but we have to. We have to do it again. Okay.
I'm going to have to go back and try the other one pretty soon. Another thing is, let me just see if I can do that. Okay.
Cape Cod perimeter walk. Walk the beaches, swim the rivers. We did that in, 10 years ago. It took us 150 days of walking, and it was 360 miles. And the rules we had, it had to be the entire perimeter with no breaks in it. Walk the beaches. If you come to a river, you swim across it. Walk on the ocean side of every building, never sneaking through backyards. Islands are optional. We didn't do it in sequence because we didn't want to do all of Falmouth in the summer and then all of Truro, and you can't do rivers in the winter, so you kind of mix it up, which was good. And we used GPSs and Google Earth. Now, some challenges. Our age, we were in our 70s, and, was that a challenge? No, it was an advantage. If I was younger, I'd say, Patty, let's do this in, a month. But no, that feeling you have that if you can walk 5 miles, but someday you walk seven, and you say, boy, I feel good about that, I'm glad I did it. We never wanted to have that feeling. We wanted to stop at 3 and go to lunch, which we pretty much did. So never get tired, go slow, enjoy the hike. So that was an advantage. The way this all started was Patty had a new hip. And as part of the hip, she went to a physical therapist, 3 times a week. And while she was there, I'd go out and walk a beach. It was in Dennis. And the next day, I'd walk a different beach. And then by the time her therapy finished, I had walked all the beaches in Dennis. And I said, gee, maybe I'll continue this. Well, I had done a little more, and pretty soon I'm by myself to drive to Provincetown by myself, and it was getting kind of, boring and overwhelming. But one day, Patty said to me, can I walk with you? So we started out short walks and progressed, and it just became totally fun. We didn't know whether we were going to be able to complete this, though, until we got to Seagull Beach in Yarmouth. And we were standing there on the beach, and Patty looked out at the point out there and said, Mark, do we have to walk that far? And I said, Patty, that's only 1.5 miles. What I didn't tell her is when you get to that 1.5 miles, it's another 2 miles over rocks. So we finished it. And at the end of that 2 mile rocky walk, Patty said, where are we walking tomorrow? And at that moment, I said, I know we can finish this. It's just a walk tomorrow, a couple of days off, maybe 2 more days of walking, and eventually we'll finish it. So we had a good ad. That was just a tremendous feeling. Another challenge is private property signs. And this is where we were good partners. I'd be walking down near the beach, and Patty would be up high near the shore, and I'd say, hey, Patty, what does that sign say? And Patty would answer,
Welcome.
She'd say, welcome, come on up. And you'd get up here and you'd see a sign like this. So she was a great partner to have that. She was more daring than I was. And come on up, Mark, it's nothing. Patty's response. The other thing, we're very fortunate to be on the Outer Cape where there's nothing but sandy beaches. But when we run across a beach like that, you kind of think, where's the beach? And how do you get by that? And we started that and said, that's not going to work. So the next day, you just swim around it. And there's Patty swimming around some walks. Another thing, we had to do a butt crawl to get by that. And the ice flow in the wintertime. Oh, here's one. Did you ever think you have an idea and you're going to make a lot of money? I've thought of that a lot. I've never made a lot of money, though. But this one was, you know, when you walk in soft sand and when your foot sinks, it just takes a lot of energy out of you. I said, what I'll do is cut down a ski to about this long, just duct tape it to my sneaker, and I'll be able to just float over those that soft sand. It was a good idea. The first beach I tried it out on was Short Wharf Beach, and I think it's Yarmouth or Barnstable. And there was a mud flat there. And I said, oh, I'll try it, mud flat. I'll just skim right across in my new skis. But the skis and the mud acted like suction cups. Do any of you remember the story of Br'er Rabbit? Yes. And the tar baby? Well, I was out in the mud flat, and you know, nothing was working. Until once I said, I'm going to give it one more big pull, and I pulled it up. My foot came out of the thing, and I went back, and there I am sitting in the mud flat saying, Mark, you're 73. You're sitting down in the mud flat. You have one ski on and one barefoot. What are you doing this? Why do you get into these situations? Well, I was never, one of the skis sunk and I was never able to retrieve it. So somebody would probably, weeks later, find this ski with a sneaker duct tape. What is this? But that's just some of the... Oh, this one was a, that's Patty. Out on Sandy Neck. I had done it before. So we had to walk from the tip of Sandy Neck, you know, around to the parking lot, and it's 6.5 miles. Patty had been to the doctor the day before, and he said, I'm giving you medicine, but you can't go out in the sun. So Patty said, well, I'm going anyway. I'll dress like this and walk in the 6.5 miles in soft sand and look at the people over her shoulder there. So my hat's off to Patty for finishing that. And I met her in the parking lot because I had kayaked her out to the end there. So I met her there, and I didn't get to appreciate. So that was alone. That was a tough walk. We had 20 swims. And, you know, when there's a hurricane, that's a good time to be out. That's the parking lot of Nauset Beach. It's flooded. That's walking along, just along Nauset Beach where you swim. And the storms had created those sand cliffs there. Now, that was exciting. Oh, Juniper Point. That's Woods Hole. We were hiking around that, of course, and it looks like we're hiking right close to the airplane house that was built by a disciple of Frank Lloyd Wright. And it looks like we were very close, but that house is probably up 10 feet above the rocks down there. So you can walk that, and I can't see the house, and they can't see me. So we were walking around that. But another thing about Patty, she gets bored kind of easy. So we get halfway around that, and Patty said, I'm going up these stairs. And then, Patty, you were there. I continued to walk. And
I had just had a hip replacement a few months before, and so it was getting too hard for me down by the rock. So I went up a flight of stairs, and I always wore a baseball hat. And if somebody, I was on somebody's property, and when the woman came out, it was like, whip off the baseball cap to show that I have all white hair and I'm old. And so she said to me, hi, I'm just the caretaker. And I said, oh, I'm, you know, blah, blah, blah. And she said, oh, would you like to see the house? So Mark, meanwhile, is going around. So we ended up meeting, and we ended up having a tour of the house.
And what was the last question?
Oh, yeah. She took us in the house, and we went up to this bedroom. And then she said, you want to stay over? And I said, no, I don't think I want to stay over. And she said, yeah, wait a second. Let's go
Thank you, Patty. So I had the GPS. There's the caretaker, that Patty's best friend. And I had the GPS in my pocket, so that's our walk around the house and the grounds and stuff like that. So that was fun. Oh, the house inside. This was the sunset dining room. On the other side of that, there was the sunrise dining room. So you could have your meals on to see the sun at any time. Now, near the end, we were probably 15 or 20 days from the end. And our feeling was, we want to finish this. This is October, and we have to get all our swimming, so we just want to finish. But we really didn't want it to end. You know, it was a year together, and it was great. In summary, it wasn't just the walk. We were alone a lot. 95% of the time, we didn't see anybody on the beach. And discover different things. Disagreements. Have any of you been with your spouse or partner and maybe an unkind word has passed between the two of you? You know, that's happened on occasion to us. But the thing about it is, Patty, we have a hike. We have to go on the hike. And the nice thing about it, the first step you take on this hike, all of that stuff that had gone on the previous half hour is just gone. And it's just like somebody pulled a shade. It's a new day. We're on our hike. And that was another unknown thing that would happen to us. And tolerance and beauty. Okay. There's one more. What we've talked about so far is some of the challenges we've had. But that's really not what the walk was about. There were so many good times, so many things we saw, that let's take a look at some of the joyful moments we had and some of the scenery we saw on our adventures, both this one and some of the others. Let's celebrate Cape Cod. And these are the dunes in Provincetown. Sunrises. And sunsets with friends, having dinner in the sunsets. It's a great place for cross-country skiing. Storms.
Providence.
I get two comments recurringly when I'm on hikes. And the first one is, we are so fortunate to be living on Cape Cod, and that's universal. And another comment I get is, I've been living here for 15 years and I never knew this place existed. So it's great to get out like this. Okay. Now let's talk about some of the artists in Cape Cod. I'm just covering three of them. And I feel these three really had Cape Cod in their bones. The first one we'll look at is Henry David Thoreau wrote a book, Cape Cod. And he spent some time on Boston Beach, and I've spent quite a bit of time on Boston Beach, particularly during COVID times. And I've collected these. I was out there a number of times. You go out by yourself. And at one time I said, nature has created a museum for us on this beach. And I'd like to take you through that now. First, there was a sculpture. It was a tree that was planted up top and got eroded away, and it's on its way. But that was a mother, a father, and a child just resting there on the beach. And then the winter crust was breaking up now, and that was exposing some ancient cities. And they were quite complex ancient cities, very detailed. And these were all in the cliffs. And at this particular day, I said, I think I'll just have a sit down, and I take a copy of Cape Cod by Thoreau with me. And I don't read any chapters, but I've underlined enough in the book that I can flip pages and, oh, I remember that book, and that was nice. But this particular day, I heard a noise. And the noise came from that ancient city up there.
Will never be more attractive than it is now.
And that was Henry David Thoreau, 170 years later, is now living up in that cliff. So it was great. It was great to see him. So I said, Henry, let's take a walk together. And so you can see Henry has shrunk a little in the preceding last 170 years. But he still had his mind and a good voice, so he was a fun guy to walk with. I said, Henry, I'll show you the museum. And the first thing we came across was nature's etchings in the sand. And at this particular time, the winter storms had blown away or washed away every bit of loose sand on the beach. So all it had was this firm sand. And that allowed the drippings to coming down off the cliffs to create these works of art. And this was a work of art, and it looks like there's some kind of religious celebration going on, and there are a number of people coming from the left to this celebration. And that's a pretty detailed piece of art. And there's a painting Mother Nature did that looks a little bit angry, and particularly this one. This one Mother Nature created, and I think she's angry, and she doesn't like the way she's being treated. I think it's the message that she was giving the viewers of this art. And this art was nice. It was like a giant etch-a-sketch. Every day, twice a day, the tide would come in and go out and leave artwork like this, and then 6 hours later, it would rip the etch-a-sketch up, create a whole bunch of new art. So that was just a fun place to be. Okay, oh, Henry. Henry, what do you think of the waves? What do you think of the storm, the surf?
Well,
Gregory's, oh, like 1,000 wild horses of Neptune, rushing to the shore, with their light manes streaming far behind.
Boy, Henry's good with words. You know, he thinks, and I said, Henry, I took a picture of that.
Gregory's.
Oh, heard that, Henry.
Wild horses of Neptune, rushing to the shore, with their white manes streaming far behind.
Okay. You're all going to be able to pass the test now at the end. And here's a picture I took, and maybe Henry David Thoreau was looking at the ocean from the same place I took this. And you can see those 1,000 wild horses of Neptune with their white manes streaming far behind. So that gave me another connection with Henry.
Sea, nibbling voraciously at the continent.
Okay, Henry, that's another good one. And at this time, there were rocks. It looks like the coast of Maine. Those rocks extended as far as the eye could see. You could not walk from the parking lot of the beach to the ocean anywhere because of these rocks. Oh, and this big rock. That's a chunk of the clay cliff that came down. Good size. Lots of little rock formations. And this is a, we're into the geology gallery in the museum now. And I'm not a geologist, but my interpretation of this is Cape Cod was formed at the end of the glacier age, 15 to 20,000 years ago. And what happened, as the glacier was melting, it melted more in the southern areas than the northern areas. So when it was melting, say, out around Syracuse or out there, that brought with it, as it was melting, all of that gray silt that was native to the Syracuse area. And then it stopped, that dried up, and then it started melting up and north, up in Quebec. And that brought with it the red or maroon layer. And that lasted, and then the glacier all melted, and it was covered over with sand and dirt, and growth happened. That shelf was created. You could walk for a mile on that shelf. That shows the nice color between the two times. And this, what I thought was rock, you could take a little twig and write in it. And I said, wow, what's this stuff made out of? So I went and grabbed a piece of the rock and just squeezed it. So it was crumbling, and as soon as it dried out, it was crumbling in my hands. And then some up top, the wind would just blow. And those piles would grow and cover the whole cliffside. Oh, and his seal, he's part of the museum. That's a seal. He found this hideout in this rock. Loved to get his face splashed with water. And he was watching out over the whole beach. And he was there for a long time. But then spring came. The waters are calm. This big rock. And within a month, big rock had collapsed. The ocean just hit it, and since it's made out of this loose sand and clay, big rock was gone. The etching garden was gone. The ancient civilizations, the geology class, and all of those rocks that prevented you from getting in the water all disappeared. And Seal, he was getting covered over. But the sand had all built up in front of him, so he wasn't getting splashed anymore. So he went back to the ocean with his friends. And Henry, before he left, there was nothing left for Henry to be here for. So I said, Henry, give me a few more comments before you leave.
In wilderness is the preservation of the world.
Thank you, Henry. And one more.
man may stand there and put all America behind him.
And that's the last line of Henry Thoreau's book, Cape Cod. And that's what the beach looks like now. And sometimes when my footprints are one of those hundreds that are there, you're walking down the beach and did that really ever happen? When I was there and saw all that activity, and it's kind of tough to believe that in that time, all of that activity was going on. So thank you, Mother Nature and Henry David Thoreau. Okay. How about a little of Edward Hopper's? Lived on Cape Cod for 40 years or 30 years. He had a neighbor, he had a house up in Wellfleet, up in Truro. Let's take a walk around Hopper's house. In this 2 mile walk, you can see five or 10 of his paintings. There's Hopper's house. He built it in 1933, and he was starting to sell paintings then. And in 1956, he had electricity put in it. So all of those times, he liked to live the simple life. And he had that huge window, and when he went out and on site for a painting, he'd sketch it sitting in his car. He'd come back, sit near that window, and do the final painting. There's Edward and his wife, Josephine. And then, I don't know if you people heard it from it down around here, but the Klein House. A gentleman named Mr. Klein wanted to build a house. And from the nice painting window, it was right in front of Hopper's view. But this was years after Hopper died. And they put that up. It's a very modest 8,000 square foot house with a nice office in it. But when it was first proposed, somehow through lax building codes, he got a CO. And the neighbors sued him, and it went to court, and the judge said, you have a CO. I can't take it away from you. But I suggest you not build that house. He said, I'm going to anyway. And he built it. And then they went to court again, and the judge said, Truro, you were wrong. Fix it. So Truro said, okay, Klein, take the house down. And then Klein died in the meantime. And the house sold with the stipulation all of this legal stuff has to go away. So the new owner said, okay, Truro, how much in fines do you think you should collect for us building that house? And it was $500,000. He said, okay, here it is. And here's another $2.5 million just for being nice. And all of a sudden, he got the CO, and all of the lawsuits went away. So it was a 12-year process, but the house is still there. And at least it's somewhat tasteful. And two comments by viewers. The town is now $3 million richer, but it also has a permanent monument to the rule of money. And the owner says, what shouldn't be lost here is how unfairly the Klein family was treated. Okay, that's enough of the Klein house. Let's look at some of his paintings. That is the only painting that Edward Hopper did of his house. And yeah, that's his house. That's his neighbor's house where he stayed as his house was being filled. These pictures can be seen from the Hammett Harbor. This particular house he was quite fond of and painted it three times. A couple of things that are gone. This was a nice picture of Boylston Beach, and that was the captain's house of the life-saving station. And he painted that, and there it was for a number of years until the storm 2 years ago came and took away the foundation, and that's all that remains of that painting. And one more painting, one of his more famous paintings is Gas, the gas station. You could still see the platform for the gas station and the pumps. And they cleared it off. And I said, that's going to be great. They're going to put up a marker, a monument. But no, they put up a firewood stand, so all traces of gas are gone now. And that's the last painting he did in 1965. Oh, what did Hopper like about Cape Cod? Edward Hopper was drawn to Cape Cod for its unique combination of light, landscape, architecture, and the peaceful ambiance it offered. These aspects provided him with endless inspiration in his work. Now, I struggle with writing. I don't like to write. So I was trying to think at the end, how can I come up with a summary statement for Hopper? So I went into ChatGPT, which is an artificial intelligence piece, and I just typed into it, what did Hopper like about Cape Cod? And ChatGPT came up with this. So I said, I'll use that. So I thought I'd at least acknowledge that. And we have to do Mary Hopper. She wrote a number of books and poems. She was a Pulitzer Prize winner. She has a poem about Blackwater Pond that she liked that I read at the start of every hike out there. And I like this statement. It shows her love of Cape Cod. People say to me, wouldn't you like to see Yosemite, the Bay of Fundy, the Brooks Range? I smile and answer, oh yes, sometime, and go off to my woods, my ponds, my sun-filled harbor. No more than a blue comma, but the world to me is the emblem of everything. And that was her statement about living on Cape Cod. And one last story about Mary Oliver. She loved animals and turtles. And she would go out there and find where the turtles were making their nest. And one day she saw the turtle come up, the mother turtle, and she followed the mother turtle. And the mother turtle laid her eggs and left it, went back to the sea. And Mary Oliver went in and took them all out. There were 27 of them. And she put 14 of them back in the nest and took 13 home and scrambled them. And what happened was, if you read Mary Oliver, she is so into nature. And part of nature is, you know, fox eats cats, cats eat mice, and so forth, that she just wanted to be part of that string of nature and participate in, just like the birds would eat the eggs that they got. Well, she wanted to participate in that. So thanks for that story, Mary. Well, that ends the show now. So I've appreciated coming here and sharing some of our stories with you. I'll be up here if anybody has any questions. I didn't take any during the session, so if anybody has any questions, I'll be there. And they have desserts in there, great dessert trays. So you're welcome to go in. Thanks to our sponsor.